Well, this morning we return to Paul's letter to the Philippians, and if you're regular here, you'll know that over recent weeks, months it is now, we've been working our way through this. And in more recent weeks, just to refresh your memories, we've looked at how Paul is exhorting the Philippians to grow in grace, to go on in the things of God, to develop as believers here in this world. And he set forth himself and other mature believers as being examples to look out for and to follow. He's given warnings about those whose God is their belly and who mind earthly things. And then at the end of chapter 3, he says this, in contrast to those worldly people, even worldly believers, we might say, our conversation is in heaven. Notice the contrast there. Our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself. Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. Now, as we know by experience, as well as by God's word, we're surrounded by pressures and spiritual dangers every day that we live. Satan is always snapping at our heels. We know the indwelling sin that is still within our hearts. We know what Paul has been exhorting us to grow as believers, to develop in our faith and in our walk before God. We know about those things that we ought to avoid, those examples that we ought to shun. We know very well all these things. And so when we come to this exhortation in chapter 4 and verse 1, we can see why it's necessary for Paul to say what he says. Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord. So stand fast in the Lord. We're going to think briefly about what that means, and then we're going to think about the motivations and reasons that Paul has given in those last couple of verses of chapter 3. Stand fast in the Lord. Paul has already used this expression earlier on in this same letter in chapter 1 and verse 27. And he also uses the same expression four times elsewhere in his letters, in Corinthians, in Galatians, and in 1 and 2 Thessalonians. Stand fast. Now, it's pretty self-evident what that means, but really it boils down to this. Don't be moved or shifted from where you are as the people of God. Don't allow anything, whether it's events and experiences or people, don't let anything or anyone shift you from your stand in faith upon the Lord Jesus Christ. All kinds of things may come our way, and we might feel ourselves at times rather to be like one of those long reeds that you see by the river sometimes, and they get swayed so easily, don't they, by the breeze. And we feel the pressure, we feel the impulses of our flesh and the temptations of the devil and things that people threaten us with and all this kind of thing that goes on in our lives. But Paul says, stand fast. Don't be moved from where or what you are. Stand fast in the Lord. And let me give you some more practical examples of what I believe this means. Stand fast in believing in your Saviour for your salvation. When memories of sin plague you, or when more recent sin shames you, stand fast in believing that Jesus Christ has died for your sins, and he's died for all of them. All of them. In him you have a true Saviour. Christ is always enough for anyone whose faith is in him. He never fails. Can we imagine that God would send his Son into the world to die for some sins, or even most sins, or nearly all sins? If he had only done something of that kind, we wouldn't have a Saviour. Because one sin unatoned for would be enough to keep us out of heaven and plunge us into hell. He's done everything. And when those memories come back, or when recent falls upset us and disturb us, as they do, and so they should, stand fast. You've a Saviour. Trust in him. We might also say, always trust in him. Don't trust in anything else. When you fail the Lord, as we all do, don't think, but I've done this, and therefore that makes up for what I've failed. That's not trusting in the Lord. And as even one or two writers point out, this is so important, don't even trust in your faith. Don't trust your believing, trust Christ. He is the one. Stand fast, believing in the Lord Jesus Christ for your salvation. Stand fast in this sense too, relying upon your Saviour in daily life. Relying upon your Saviour in daily life. Do we need courage? Do we need strength? Do we need guidance? Where do we look? Upon whom do we trust? It's always in him. Stand fast. Don't trust yourself. Don't trust your impulses. Don't trust the opinions of other people. Bring them to the Word of God, and bring them through the Word of God to Christ, and have him affirm or deny what you think is the right thing to do. Stand fast, relying upon the Lord in daily life. After all, he never makes a mistake, and he'll never let us down. Stand fast, thirdly, living for your Saviour. This is what Paul has been labouring in this very chapter, and we've been labouring that in the messages over recent weeks. Living for the Saviour, living for the Lord. It's our purpose in life. Apprehending that for which we have been apprehended. Living for the glory and the honour of God. Living out life in that way that the Lord requires of us. Stand fast in that. Don't think for one moment that we're here to live for ourselves or for the mere pleasures of the world. No, we're here for the honour and the glory of God. Stand fast in these things. Don't be deterred when life gets difficult, or when we face discouragements or disappointments in Christian life and service. Now, that's a big issue these days, isn't it? If we're earnest and sincere to publish abroad the gospel of Jesus Christ, it's a pretty dismaying kind of picture out there, isn't it? You know, when we take the table out into the witness table out into the centre of the town, we see hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people walk by as though we're invisible. They see the texts upon the board. There's the offer of the tracts, the Gospels, and the little booklets that will be of great help to people in seeking after the Lord. And yet, how many are interested? They're dead in their trespasses and sins. And if we have a heart and a compassion for the lost, and we see that sort of reaction, it can become very, very discouraging. But stand fast. Stand fast. Who knows what God will yet do in this poor nation of ours. Don't be deterred either in living for your Saviour when you fall, and we do fall. The enemy is there with his wiles and too often his successes. But stand fast. We might lose the battle, but we won't lose the war, because Christ is there for us. Stand fast in living for your Saviour. And really, I've jumped into this already, but stand fast in proclaiming the gospel message. Don't give up. Don't give up. Perhaps there's a neighbor or someone in your family and you've been praying for them for years and you've been taking every opportunity to bring the conversation round to the gospel of grace, and you wonder what else you can say or what different way you can put it. You wonder what more fervent prayers you can bring on their behalf than you've already brought before. And you think to yourself, well, where's this going to get anybody? Nothing seems to be happening. Prayer doesn't seem to be heard. Stand fast. Stand fast in those individuals that we know that are far from God at the moment, but God in a moment can bring them near and save their souls. Stand fast in proclaiming the gospel message. And I emphasize this too, the gospel message. There's only one gospel message. There's only one gospel of redeeming grace. There's not another. And so many well-meaning people, no doubt, in this age — it's no different really from any other age, but in this age we see it with our own eyes, don't we, that the gospel message gets massaged into something very different from what you find in the Bible. It becomes diluted and weakened. It's either a works salvation or it's an emotional feeling that is propounded, or it's believe in Jesus Christ but go on as you wish kind of message. It's all kinds of things in many cases except the true gospel. Paul warned in his letter to the Galatians about another gospel which is not a gospel, and preaching another Christ who is not the Christ. There's only that one message. And though the world scoffs and people mock at what we say, we must keep on with that same one soul-saving message. Stand fast upon that essence of gospel truth. And stand fast in proclaiming the gospel message in the sense that it is our privilege as well as our duty to preach it. And it is. Now, strictly speaking, many would say this, strictly speaking, when Paul says that we are ambassadors for Christ, strictly speaking, perhaps that applies to gospel ministers. But you can, I think, legitimately broaden that out and speak of all of us as being ambassadors for Christ, because that's effectively what we do. If Christ is our Saviour, wherever we go and whoever we meet, we are an emissary for the Lord Jesus Christ. We take not only the message with us, we take Him with us, because His Spirit indwells our souls. Stand fast. This is a privilege. This is a high honour that Christ would put this glorious gospel message into earthen vessels like we are. And we don't feel fit for it, do we? We feel as though anything that holy comes our way is contaminated by our sinful nature. And the fact that God persists with us and takes us up and uses us is an astonishing thing, astonishing demonstration of His grace toward us as well as toward others. Stand fast in realizing the privilege and the honor that's ours in proclaiming God's great gospel. Stand fast then. Now then, what does Paul give us in terms of reasons and encouragements and motivations? You notice that verse 1 of chapter 4 begins like this: therefore, my brethren. That's typical of the Apostle Paul, isn't it? He gives doctrine, he gives certain statements, and then he says, therefore. In other words, all that he's been saying has an application. Because of this, do this. Because of that, think like this. That's how he works these things out. Now, what has he been saying then immediately before this statement? Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved, long for my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. So we might say to the Apostle Paul, well, why, and what can you suggest to me that will help me and encourage me and strengthen me and drive me on? Well, you've got the answer to that here in verses 20 and 21 of the previous chapter. For our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself. He takes our thoughts, doesn't he, toward heaven, toward glory, to where Christ is. And he's been encouraging us and exhorting us to live godly, righteous lives, to grow in grace and all the rest of it, to follow and to be good examples and to avoid those that might be a hindrance to us. Our conversation is in heaven. Christ is in heaven, and it's to heaven that we're going. In other words, down here, there's much to do, much to make progress with in our own souls, much service to render to the Lord. But never forget this, that our conversation is in heaven, that Christ is in heaven, and that we are going to heaven. Heaven is presented to us in these two verses, and it really is an exhortation to us to become more heavenly minded. More heavenly minded. And there's a whole range of things that Paul brings out here. First of all, he says, we belong to heaven. That's what this opening phrase in verse 20 means. Our conversation is in heaven. Our citizenship is there. It's where we belong. This is a theme that Paul brings out repeatedly, isn't it? But he's labouring the point because it needs to be laboured. We're not here forever. Even if we're here for 90 or 100 years, what is that compared to eternity? Where we really belong is not here, it's in heaven. It's our citizenship that is there, a holy place and a glorious place, and our own final and eternal dwelling place. Our citizenship, our conversation is in heaven. Now we know this, but let me remind you, we already have our title deeds. And those deeds are signed in the blood of Jesus Christ. Now you think about how the purchase of a property down here in this world, this present world, how it works. Now you see the property that you'd like to purchase and you go through all the rigmarole of doing that, and that for some occasions that can be a long protracted process, as well we know, but finally it all goes through, the contracts are exchanged, and the whole thing is legally binding, and there you have it, as it were. You have the title deeds in your hands. That property is now yours. You haven't moved in yet, but it's yours. Heaven is ours. We haven't moved in yet, but it's ours. And Christ has purchased it for us. He holds those title deeds in his own hands. They're safe there. None can ever rob us of those deeds because he's got them. He secured them for us. And all that remains for us is to go to that place. That's where we belong. Our citizenship, our conversation is in heaven. Well, what else does he say? From whence also we look for the Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ. From whence also we look for the Saviour. He's talking there about the Saviour's return. From whence? From that place. That's telling us that if he returns to the world from heaven, that's where he is now. Self-evident. Our Saviour is in heaven. That's another motivation for us in life. It's a great comfort for us in life. There he is, not as he was when he was here in this world, but he is there as the one who has died for our sins, risen again for our justification, entered into glory and is seated at the right hand of the Majesty on high, and he is glorified there. Glorified there. And he is seated upon the throne of God, almighty in power and in authority, ruling over all things. That's what's happening. The world will never think that this can be true, because the world rejects the whole notion of a sovereign God. And shame upon us if we forget that's true as well. But that's where he is. That's where our Saviour is. That's what our Saviour is. The sovereign Lord who rules over all. And therefore, when we are here in this world, and when everything seems to be against us and everything is dragging us down and the very duties of life seem to be so hard to accomplish, never forget that Christ is ruling above. And he is not ruling as one who is so distant and so high and so mighty that he doesn't give one thought toward his subjects. Nothing could be further from the truth. He is in heaven as our high priest, with sympathy, with compassion, with a feeling heart toward us down here. That's what we have. Oh, we find it so hard at times, don't we? So hard. And yet, what drives us on, or what should drive us on, is not only do we belong in heaven, but in heaven, even at the moment, our Saviour rules over all things, and his heart is toward us with love and sympathy, and his hand stretches out constantly with his blessings and with that mighty grace which is in his soul. That's where he is. Or if only we could think more of our Saviour and where and what he is for us, it would surely be a greater help to us in our daily lives. So that's where he is now, and that's where, or from where, one day he will return to this world. Our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ. We look. You remember in Acts chapter 1, the Lord was taken up probably when his disciples were standing there. And he was lifted up and he went through the clouds and he disappeared from their view. And the angel came and said, "Why do you stand here looking up into heaven?" As though that's the end. "As you saw him go, so you will see him come." That's what the angel's message was. And he's coming. He's coming back to this world in all his power and his glory. And when he comes back, that will be that full and final and complete victory over every one of his enemies. That's what's going to happen. Well, I said that we may lose some battles, but we're going to win the war, and it's not us that win it, it's the Saviour that will win it for us and for himself. All his enemies will be put down. Christ shall return to this world to wind up this present age and introduce the age that is to come. From whence also we look. Are you looking? Are you looking? Are you expecting? Are you waiting? No, we don't know when. We don't know when, but you do get the sense, don't you, from the New Testament writings that they were almost expecting that it could be at any time. This wasn't some remote kind of theological proposition as far as they were concerned. We're looking for the Saviour to come. They were expecting him to come because that's precisely what he had promised he would do. There's another encouragement for us as we move into verse 21. "Who shall change our vile body that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body." Now, this is where Paul, as it were, leaps over one or two things to bring our thoughts into the very final act of our redemption. Now, we know that when the body dies, the soul is separated from the body, the soul goes into heaven to be with the Lord. We know that's what death in biblical terms actually is. But Paul leaps over that and he goes way, way off into the future sometime when Christ returns and there's the resurrection. The resurrection. And souls that have gone to glory will be reunited with the bodies that died and were buried here in this world. Who shall change our vile body that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body. He's talking about the resurrection and that entrance, body as well as soul, into heaven that will be for eternity. That's what Paul seems to be looking to here. Now, look at the terms that he uses. Who shall change our vile body that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body. Now, there's a big contrast there between the vile body and likeness unto Christ's glorious body. Vile body. Now, this is where the commentators and the Greek language specialists get heated, rather, because they think, well, vile is a worthy translation of the term, but a more a term that might conjure up a little more to us is the literal translation, which is the body of humiliation. A body of humiliation. Now, how does that work? Why is this body, he's talking about the human body, the flesh, our bones and flesh and blood and all the rest of it. Why is that a body of humiliation? Well, think of it in this way, that when the Lord created the heavens and earth and put Adam into it, Adam's body was a glorious body. It was created perfect. It wasn't subject to weakness and illness and so on and so forth, not in that original sinless state. It was, like everything else, created perfect. But what happened? In pride, in arrogance, Adam rebelled against God. Adam followed the pattern of the devil, who, in pride, wanted to take the throne of God to himself. And Adam followed in that pathway. I will rebel against God. I will do what I want to do. I will lead my life as I wish to lead it. So he rose up in pride. And what did God do in response to that? Well, punishment came. The threat of death. The visitation of spiritual death. But that visitation of spiritual death was extended, of course, to the death of the body. And as Adam rose up in pride against God, God put him down. He humiliated him. He humiliated him by making him subject to spiritual death, but he humiliated him by making that perfect body to be one that was, instead of one that was perfect and strong and mature and wonderful and capable, he made that body to be one that was capable of weakness and the suffering of pain and the suffering of illness and at the end the suffering of death. You rise up against God and that's what God does to you. He humiliates you and he humbles you before his mighty presence. So that's why this is a vile body. It's a body in a state of humiliation before God. And our bodies, as we know, weaken and die and perish and return to the dust from which they've been created. Ah. But you see, when Christ saves us, he saves our souls, and when we die, the soul goes to glory, and this body, as it lays in the ground, goes to the finality of that humiliation, dust lying in a coffin. But when the resurrection comes, this vile body that is laid in this state of humiliation is then fashioned like unto his glorious body. No humiliation then. That self-same body that was laid in humiliation in the tomb is raised up and fashioned afresh as unto the glorious body of Jesus Christ. In the fullness and perfection of human form and strength, capable and fitted to live forever and not to be a tool and an instrument of sin as it was in this world. Shame upon us. Humiliation is ours for using our bodies in the way that we do. But in glory, it will be under the absolute and sovereign control of our souls, which are conformed unto the souls of Christ, and our bodies will become instruments of holiness and righteousness to serve God forever in that place. Body as well as soul. Oh, what a prospect. What a prospect. We think of ourselves in this world. I know that older friends are always saying this kind of a thing. I can't do what I used to do for the Lord. No doubt. No doubt. And we do, and we comfort ourselves with this very pertinent and important truth. No, we can't do what we used to do, but we can do what we can do. And if we can't do anything else, we can pray unto God. And who knows what good that does for the Church of Jesus Christ. Never say you can't do anything for the Lord anymore. Yes, you can. You can cry unto God from your bed, and the Lord will hear your prayers, and God will answer your prayers. But my friends, be encouraged in this, that the day is coming, beyond that day when your body is laid in the grave and it becomes once again the dust from which it was created. One day that trumpet will sound and that self-same body will be raised up, incorruptible, fashioned as unto the likeness of the glorious body of Jesus Christ. And in heaven, that's where you belong, that's where you're going, that's where Christ will take you. You will be a servant of God forever and ever, body as well as soul. Now, doesn't that drive you on? Doesn't that encourage you here in this life? All the struggles and the failings and the weakness that I feel, all the setbacks, one step forward, two steps back, that's how it seems at times. Oh, but the day's coming when this body will not be a drag upon us. It won't fight against us. It won't contend against us. We'll have complete control over it. It will do exactly what we want it to do. And what we want it to do will be exactly what God wants it to do. And there will be perfect harmony in glory forever and ever. And we'll serve him body and soul. It's almost unimaginable. And we would never dream that it could be so were it not for the fact that God has so promised it to us. And that's how finally we shall enter into heaven. Now, fifthly, you've been counting, but this is fifthly, we shall definitely enter into heaven, body and soul. Just look at the words again. He shall change our vile body. Notice that. Shall. I love those words when we find them in the scriptures. He shall. That is not just a prediction. It's even more than a promise. It's a decree. A decree that comes from heaven. He shall do this. He shall do this. He shall change our vile body. It's certain because it's a divine decree that can never be overturned. And it's certain, of course, because of divine power. All very well for someone to decree something, but if they can't fulfill what they have decreed, then it becomes an empty thing. But this is not emptiness. These are not mere words. He shall, because he can. Who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according, this is it, according to the working whereby he is able, even to subdue all things unto himself. According to the working whereby he is able to subdue all things unto himself. Paul is referring there to the use of Christ's eternal and infinite power, whereby he will bring all things and subdue all things unto himself. Now, I don't know whether you noticed, but in that passage from the Hebrews there, Paul writes in that second chapter about all things being put under his feet. He says, at the moment, we don't see all things under his feet. We don't see it, but we're going to. We're going to. You see, at the moment, Christ is sovereign, reigning from his throne above, but everything seems to be against him, doesn't it? The world seems to have the upper hand. Satan seems to have the run of the world. And how can we imagine then that all things are under the feet of Christ? Well, they are. It's simply that in divine wisdom, the devil is allowed to do certain things and to run in certain ways and to accomplish certain things. But never mistake this as an overturning of the scriptures. He's in control. The devil isn't. But one day, all things, the whole world, and the devil himself will be in subjection before the throne of Christ. Notice or remember what Paul says here in chapter 2. God hath also highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth, and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. We go about our Christian lives in an unbelieving, wicked, evil, hostile world. And it's hard at times. It's hard. But the day will be coming when all of the enemies that we see raging against Christ and his church at the moment will be in subjection before him. Can you imagine? Kneeling before him and owning him to be what we already know him to actually be. All things subdued, tamed, brought into submission. No more raging opposition nor apparent victory for Satan. Sixthly, this, and this is lastly, this will be finally the victory of Christ and his church. The day will come when the King will be seen in all his glory and all upon his throne, all things put under him. And what a day that's going to be. Millions will wail, believers will rejoice, and that heavenly eternity opens up before us. No struggling, no failings for sin, no sorrows for sin, no grief over the past or the present, no fear over the future, joy unbounded with Christ forever, altogether made like unto him. Now, that's what's coming. That's what's coming. He's there already, and he's coming back here, and we're going to go to be with him where he is, and we, body and soul, are going to be like him. Now, doesn't that make your heart sing? Doesn't that make your life seem lighter? Doesn't that make your burdens seem easier to bear? Because that's who we are. That's where we belong. That's where our Saviour is. That's from where our Saviour will come. And that's where he's going to take us, to be with him forever and to be like him. Well, I think that's the pinnacle of encouragements. It doesn't get any better than that, does it? It can't get any more glorious than that. Therefore, this is the application. All that being true, therefore, stand fast in the Lord. Amen. And may God help us so to do.